Good afternoon, good morning, good evening. Welcome to the final Forward 50 Channel 4 workshop of 2021. And this is going to be a great one. I am super excited about government as a platform from principle to strategy to implementation. My name is Robert Butler, and I'm an engagement officer, digital disruptor, and GC Digital colleague to many in the Government of Canada, Shared Services Canada, an Asian male wearing a white and gray, you know, shirt in my home office here hosting at Forward 50. I absolutely love these workshop sessions because they're interactive, and this is going to be nothing less than interactive. So if you are currently joining us on the GRIP platform, there's a Zoom link at the bottom. I want you to click that and come join our Zoom meeting so you can interact directly with Pia Andrews, who I'll be introducing to you in just a couple of minutes. Strongly suggested, please come join us in the Zoom room. And of course, throughout every event here, make sure that you meet the code of contact to help us keep in safe and an inclusive space of all. Use the hashtag Forward50 and at Forward50Conf on Twitter to be part of the conversation. So once again, please join the Zoom call listed below. Now, Pia Andrews is an open government and data ninja. Honestly, ninjas are usually unseen, but she has been driving data policy and legislation transformation in the public sector for the decade in the open. I didn't put the ninja thing. That was the talking points that I got. So I just want you to know, in the open. Following her incredible Forward 50 extra session with Audrey and Christo, where they discussed government as a platform, we're going to get into going from principle to strategy and to implementation. So in that session, they worked with some awesome folks behind the scenes to create a mirror board, and we'll be using that later in the workshop. So once again, to participate in the workshop and not just watch, make sure you click the Zoom link below. And raise your hand if you want to chime into the discussion. At any point, please chime in. This is an interactive session. So let's give a Forward 50 warm welcome to Pia Andrews. Over to you, Pia.
Thank you so much for having me. I will point out that the best way to hide is in plain sight. So you never know. I do want to say thank you so much for everyone for coming along to this workshop. What we're going to try to do is we've got it in three parts. And of course, there's heaps of people here joining us in the Zoom space. And so we'll be able to have a real conversation is the goal. And do a little bit of hands-on Gov as a platform hacking together. So that should be fun. So we're going to do it in three parts. I'm going to do a bit of an introduction just to set the scene for just a few minutes about Gov as a platform, just for any newbies in the room. Then I'm going to give you two examples of two different methods that are helpful methods with an example of each. I'll be certainly covering what we did with Audrey and Christo a few weeks back. And if you haven't seen them, make sure you go and check out the various videos, the pre-game, the game, and the post-game from that session, because there's a lot of detail we went into, which is for people who really want to get involved. But the other method I'm going to show you is a method we used here in Aotearoa, New Zealand. And I do want to take a moment to pay respect to Indigenous First Nations past, present, and future leaders and contributors to our communities in all of our different countries and areas. And here in Aotearoa, of course, it's the Māori people. Intro, couple of use cases, and then we're going to get into the mirror board, where you are all going to be invited to participate and contribute to the same mirror board that we used for our exercise a couple of weeks back. And then we're going to talk about how to build it. So let's get started just with a little bit of an introduction. I'm going to just do this bit to camera, and then I'll be using just a couple of slides just to show you some of the frameworks that we have built out in these different places. The first thing to understand, and I think a lot of people get confused about with Gov as a platform, is Gov as a platform is really two things, two things that are complementary but sometimes get confused for each other. Gov as a platform, first and foremost, is a philosophy, and secondly, is a very pragmatic design and architectural principle. And if you don't apply it in both ways, then you will lose the value. So Gov as a Platform as a term was coined by Tim O'Reilly, you know, more than a decade ago. And he was really looking at the notion, you know, the rise of platform frameworks, such as, you know, the Apple platform, Google platform, you know, Amazon now, where companies were creating means by which they could deliver their own products and services, but have the foundations of that available for anyone to build on, and making it easy for effectively leveraging the scale and opportunity of large platforms. And but it's that idea that government could be a platform that we all, you know, can stand on is an important one, because government will always, particularly in countries like ours, particularly in countries like New Zealand, Canada, Australia, where our governments are presumed by the public to be means of helping people live well, means of people being able to stand on and deliver new value and be able to create new value and be able to support just that little bit of extra balance in a sometimes quite turbulent world, as we all know very well now. So being able to say, well, the way that we deliver our own services, why don't we deliver them in a way that enables others to build upon the reusable parts? So as a philosophy, it starts from the premise, the presumption that we aren't just a king in the castle, that we are a node in a network, and that we want to not just do the thing that we are responsible for, but we want to do it in a way that democratizes value creation. It's a really key term that creates the opportunity for other people to create value. So as a philosophy, the idea that government isn't there just to do stuff to people or for people, but to enable with people and to actually support people to do it, in some cases, for themselves. And part of that is also building government systems that can actually interoperate with self-sovereign systems. You know, some of our communities might want to have their own identity platforms, as we're seeing here in Aotearoa, New Zealand, where there are self-sovereign Māori identity systems being set up. And why wouldn't government support a Māori IDP when it supports a bank IDP? So there's some really interesting opportunities there around the philosophy of Gov as a Platform. And from an architectural principle, there's a couple of key concepts there. Making sure that when you build stuff, you don't build a big monolith that treats every function the same, but rather you start to break down, what are the reusable parts? What are the reusable parts of this? And if every function you're looking at, you're saying, well, is this reusable? Not just across our own services or not just across government, but is there any aspect of this that could be reusable outside of government? Just asking that simple question early in the piece, before you build, before you design, means that you have a better chance then of building modular parts where capabilities that could be reusable are. So in terms of the philosophy and the architectural principle, I'd actually, you know, in those two respects, I'd actually like to invite you to share. Would anyone like to share an example of applying Gov as a Platform as a principle, or applying Gov as a Platform as an architectural design mechanism, and you know, just to sort of kick things off and to have the start of our discussion. I think hands can go up, but Rob, if you don't mind me calling on you first, and any thoughts about how you might apply it as a principle or as a design pattern?
Oh boy. Well, I mean, if have I understood it, maybe you could just frame it so that I can completely understand. I am not a subject matter expert in this area, as we were discussing earlier. So let's pretend I know absolutely nothing as government as a platform, and from the very beginning. So in layman's terms, 30 seconds, what would that mean to me?
How would you make government something that other people can build value on? Like, so, what? And if you in your work were to apply government as a platform as a principle, the concept that we make government something that doesn't just do things to people or for people, but actually provides the ability for people to create new value for themselves. Well, you know, I mean, you've been in the open data space for a while. You've got some good examples there. How do you see applying that as a principle or as a practice?
Okay. So would it apply in the case of building products for citizens, like for instance, you know, like open source software? Is that the same thing?
Yeah, well, it's one example for sure.
Yeah, so I really think open source software is really important because, you know, where we design in one government somewhere else, we can copy and paste and then share with other governments, like in the GovUK where they develop some of those products. Susie Floresco mentioned here, the early concept of life event bundles done in Ontario 10 years ago, bringing three jurisdictions together for a service to new parents, this idea was taken to the next level. Susie, do you want to expand on that?
Well, no, my thought was that service event bundles, life event bundles, were a very early iteration of this sort of thing. And that was government doing government as a platform by itself for citizens. What Pia's talking about is more taking it to the next level of allowing people to take our bits, as it were, and make them into something useful. One example, which may or may not be popular with the audience overall, is that grassroots site covid-vaccine.ca, which took the open data from the government site and gave locations of where vaccines were available, but also, and this is the less good part, because if nothing is always good, well, it is rare that something is always totally good. They started offering QR codes, and they won't work for actual official identification. However, the app recognizes this and just flags it that, hey, this is not an official code, so please try again.
Yeah, no, that's right. Duane, I'll come to you in just a moment, but please, anyone else, throw your hand up as well. I think part of this is recognizing that the making government components available does a couple of things. First of all, it actually helps us across departments. If I need to make the eligibility criteria for something available, and another department can tap into that, so that when they're serving their client, they can sort of say, oh, by the way, here's something that might be relevant to you, or another jurisdiction can say, by the way, here's something relevant to you, or another service provider or a nonprofit, being able to actually make it so that we are not just playing on our own little island, but recognizing that we are actually part of an ecosystem of service providers, and that citizens and non-citizens will go to wherever is most comfortable for them, given that point in life, or given that trust, or given that circumstance. And so being able to make what we do mashable is critical, because there is actually no entity in life that's going to 100% serve everything a person needs. But if we can make it so that we can be part of a mashable ecosystem, then lots of different things can be brought together. I can imagine an iwi here in New Zealand being able to say, well, our community, you know, have these kinds of needs, these kinds of problems, these kinds of opportunities. And so we're going to pull in some of the eligibility information from this department, some of the food bank information from this nonprofit, some of the digital education programs that are relevant to us from our local government, and to create a bit of a package to help the folk in our community to upskill according to the things that we're focused on as a community. So making ourselves mashable is kind of the key here. A lot of people talk about Gov as a platform like Lego blocks, and like trying to build the reusable bits so that we can build lots and lots and lots of different sort of things as a community, not just as a department. There's a couple of hands up. Let's have a bit more of a corridor, a bit more of a discussion. Go ahead, Duane.
Hello, Pia. You just basically stole all the words from my mouth.
Oh, I'm sorry. Please go ahead. Do it again.
I was going to describe a scalable world of Lego blocks, in that the smallest levels within a cluster, within an IT department, there are reusable microservices that can be used within that ecosystem. But as you go up in that onion, or in that scale, across a jurisdiction within Ontario and from different ministries, there's these reusable microservers, services, these Lego blocks that you can put together in all kinds of different ways. But then you have the other side of the pie, which is the citizens and actually having them access to these Lego blocks and them making their own Lego blocks so that we can then build them together in some beautiful buildings. So really it's just scaling up the idea of those Lego blocks, but you really just said it all much better than me. So
oh no, you said it beautifully. Thank you, Dwayne. And I think that and this is where I think it gets kind of interesting, because then you start looking at what are the characteristics of making them usable, right? Because if you want to use those Lego blocks, then there's a couple of things that you need. You know, you can't get four pieces of Lego that are completely different standards, you know, completely different sizes, completely different, you know, interconnectors, and try to force them together. This is where standards become important. This is where having consistency is important, but it's also reliability. When we, and there's a lovely comment there about open data, and yes, open.canada.ca is a great example of government enabling government as a platform. So remember, government as a platform does not mean government platforms. Platforms are a means of enabling it, but government as a platform to a philosophical sense is broader. And as people interested in Gov as a platform, one of the key jobs for us all is to actually consider the user needs of government as a platform. A user need of government as a platform is more like developer needs. So you all do, you know, or many of you will do CX and looking at what the user research says, and what the user needs are for an end user service. The needs of Gov as a platform is actually the next level down. It's almost developer needs. What's the DX, the developer experience? And what's the machine experience? Which means that having a spreadsheet to download is not really sufficient. You need to have programmatic interfaces. You need to have reliable programmatic interfaces to really do Gov as a platform well. You want to engage with the developer community and say, what is it that would make this reusable component that we think has, first of all, will this have value for you? You know, and what will have value to you? Okay, now how can we make it available in a form that you can build with and build upon? So actually building DX, developer experience, into your design of government as a platform and of reusable platforms is very important. I'll give you a small example. We had some APIs, actually they were data APIs in Australia that were heavily relied upon. And but we found out when we started looking at what are the minimum requirements for, if you like, for performance, we were starting to look at things like, you know, latency and uptime and those kinds of things as part of the measurement framework for Gov as a platform. And it was really interesting because we found some really important APIs that people really wanted, some really important services, really important Lego blocks that were turned off at 5:30 p.m. on a Friday and came back on at 8:30 a.m. on a Monday. And it infuriated people because their products would stop working on a weekend. So really being able to get into developer experience is a good technique for you. I've got a couple more comments in here. Not UX research team made sure we had a standardized set of questions and answers that align with other departments so we could compare data. Sharing design patterns and methods and techniques is all helpful as well, particularly if not just across government, but other people can use them as well. If we have to build a digital service standard, why wouldn't we, you know, do it in the open so other people can reuse it? So there's definitely reusability isn't just about technical capabilities. It is definitely also about design patterns, methods, you know, these things are all helpful when you, and this is where you start thinking about government as a platform, as a principle. Anything you do that someone else could use to benefit their quality of life, you know, that doesn't, you know, that doesn't create harm is worth sharing openly, because, and the more openly we work as a government, the more value people can draw from what is effectively paid for by the public dollar. Everything we do is publicly funded. So why wouldn't we be trying to open as much of it as possible for public good and for public value creation? So absolutely, that's a really good point. Thank you to that person. Greg, I'll come to you in a moment. There's just a few interesting comments. I'd really love the folk in the chat, if you would like to put your hands up to share some of these comments, if you'd be interested. Do you make this information available to others to use and build on? Martha, I don't suppose you would like to throw that question to Luke in the conversation rather than me just parroting it.
Yeah, I think he actually answered it in the chat. He said that he shared that they share it with anyone who wants it, but it's not publicly available at the moment. But yeah, that reminds me, there's like GCpedia, which is an example of a platform that I think people use and benefit from.
Yeah, for sure. I think people get very worried about why would we put this out if most people won't use it? I mean, you can say, I remember having a discussion, a very interesting discussion years ago about annual reports. And because when you apply, you know, traditional measures, oh, well, not many people use it, so maybe it's not relevant. No, it's a basic principle of, you know, administrative, good administration and transparency and all the rest of it. There are things that just because a lot of people won't use it doesn't mean it doesn't have value. So the key thing here is, rather than torturing yourself over whether this has value, like rather than the test being, does this have significant value and therefore should we open? The opposite test should be true. Why not just work in the open? And if there's a reason to not open it, then we close it. And if you just work in the open as your natural state, then value will come up that goes beyond what you can imagine, because we don't know all the answers. Greg, I might invite you to the stage. Go ahead.
Thanks, Pia. So for Greg Froh, Government of British Columbia. We're using government as a platform as kind of our North Star with a lot of our digital government efforts. One that comes to mind, though, is that, you know, taking that platform approach is really about democratizing the access to government data. And I look at a company like Dye & Durham, where historically what they've done is they've built systems that scrape government systems. So for example, when I worked with our corporate registry, they were actually part of our change management flow, which put them in a privileged position with regard to accessing the corporate registry. Mm-hmm. Whereas if yeah, I mean, this is going back 20 years, but whereas nowadays, if we were to redo that, taking a platform approach, it would provide that same access to a number of different law firms, right?
So. No, that's exactly right. When you, and we saw this and this is my personal opinion and it doesn't reflect any of my previous or past employees, rah, rah, rah. But I was amazed and quite shocked actually when the US government decided to make a position where they made one company have a complete monopoly on effectively encoding taxation rules. But not just that, they actually made it illegal effectively for departments to do their own encoding of the rules, which is fascinating. From my perspective, and again, it comes down to a philosophical starting point. There is a different philosophy about what the role and purpose of government is in the US, which is quite different to a lot of the rest of us. So for us, the idea of providing legislation as code or rules as code is a lot more natural because there's a starting point of equal access to, equitable access to law, the importance of social justice, the importance of the public being able to build on the back of government and the importance of government as a force for good, or it can be a force for good. At least it's an accountable and force for public stewardship is an important principle. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch now to giving you a little bit of a presentation of a couple of pieces of work around Gov as a platform recently, and then we're going to come back to interactive stuff in about 15 minutes, but I shall share my screen and I'm going to show you two methods that I have applied in recent times I think that you'll find interesting. So excuse me going to slides, but here we go. So the two methods basically correspond to, one is looking at the land and one is looking to the sky. So the one looking to the land is very much about looking at where we stand, what the principles are, what the context is, what the constitutional framework that we're working within is, and then building out from there. And the second method is looking to the horizon and saying roughly where do we want to be? What is the future state that we're looking for? And let's build towards that. So the first example I'm going to give you is actually from New Zealand about looking at the ground. And then I'm going to give you the sky example about what we did with Audrey and Christo. And then we'll, off the back of that, we're going to get into the mirror board and start doing some hacking together. Okay, so Method number one, this values-based framework approach. There's a lot of sort of questions you can ask. And yes, that's a picture of me. I was going to try to embed myself in the video, but it just didn't work. And so I just took a picture. Looking at what is the role of government? Now, this is different in every country. So Gov as a platform, even though there are some principles that will be the same and some characteristics will be the same, and amongst a lot of our countries, there will be, you know, areas that we can directly share and structures of government that will be common enough that we can do it together. But there will always be specific context, specific historical and emerging context of the role of government. And remember, the role of government isn't even a fixed in time thing as well. It's changed over the decades and over the millennia. Oh, not millennia, over the centuries. Millennia, that would be fun. But the role of government now, I think we also need to think about in the context of, you know, misinformation, deepfakes, globalized world, all the rest of it. There's a very interesting question that we should be asking ourselves, given the function and purpose and culture and accountability of government. Are there things that we should be doing that we're not doing now in order to help people live well in the digital age? But in any case, having a think about the role of government. The second thing is to think about constitutional, cultural, and values context. To think about the characteristics of the digital age and, you know, and what everything we've got today has sort of evolved out of the industrial age, or most of the things we have today have evolved out of the industrial age. And so to the point made earlier, how would we do it today? What is the purpose of our organizations, and how would we redo it if we were to do it today? I've got characteristics of digital twice, sorry. And how would we ensure trustworthy systems always has to be in there? So one of the things we did just over the last 4 weeks since I left Service Canada, I've done a little piece of work around digital public infrastructure here in New Zealand. So we looked at, you know, at a high level, what are the public sector responsibilities? I won't go into this into great depth, but you basically have your foundational authorities at the bottom, which usually comes down to your laws, rules, your constitutions. In New Zealand, there is not a constitution. There's a non-statutory constitution made up of several pieces, including the treaty. And then there's records and standards. So these are sort of foundational authorities, on top of which you have a whole bunch of different delivery mechanisms, on top of which you have the means by which people actually interact with government. And all of it, of course, is subject to and overseen by the citizens, parliament, commissions, courts, audits, fourth estate, et cetera. So in designing out what we're doing, we can start to think about even these layers. Why not have everything that is a foundational authority? Why isn't that available programmatically? If we actually have had government, people talk about digital twins as a digital twin of the geospatial environment. Why don't we have a digital organizational twin of government, where we have a linked data set of all of the departments, their structures, their accountabilities, their authorities, their policies? And if you had that as a big linked data set right down to the structure, then you can start to do some clever things about automating reporting, automating machinery government changes, structural changes, et cetera. There's some really clever stuff you can do once you actually have a digital organizational twin of government. In New Zealand, we then, of course, went right back to the treaty as our framework. In New Zealand, just really quickly, and for those who already know, apologies, but most of you I don't think will. So the treaty here is a partnership between iwi, Te Māori, and the Crown. And it has three parts to it. This is all in Te Reo Māori, my apologies. But in short, Article 1 said that the Māori agreed that the land could be governed by the Crown, uniquely governed by the Crown. So no one, they wouldn't sell land to other people, they'd sell it to the Crown, and then the Crown would administer it. And the Article 2 basically said that the Crown would respect as sovereign, Māori and iwi being able to have chieftainship over their land, their laws, their precious things, their villages, etc. Their ways of living. And then the third article was that Māori would get equal rights and privileges and protections as citizens of the Crown. So we started thinking about, very broadly, what, and I'll make all of this available, so we're not going to go into it into great detail, but just as a framework, we started thinking, okay, what are then the relevant things to consider for New Zealand in the digital age if we're to use this framework? So then, of course, Article 1 became, if it's about government over their land, well, what's the digital land? What's the word whenua, which is the word for land, is also the word for placenta, because it's about what sustains you, you know, because you're sustained by the land. So what is needed to sustain us, to support life in the digital world? We could then start asking the questions around, okay, well, what are the things that need to be shared, the common things that would serve many or all at scale and that would actually democratize that value creation, et cetera? What would reduce the barriers to creating self-sovereign systems, and what would support the other two articles? What would support people to have sovereignty over their own lives and culture, but would also support people to have the equal rights? So digital land became the first one. The second one, chieftainship over lands, et cetera, we started thinking about, what does it mean to support personal and community ownership and control over data, over policies, over laws, and how would we actually start new policies and new infrastructure from a Te Ao Māori, from a Māori knowledge system and practices approach, rather than starting it from our own approaches? Service design is a fantastic mechanism, but it doesn't necessarily get you the best outcomes in an Indigenous community, because the very way of going about seeking user feedback is a Western construct. So actually thinking about different sort of knowledge system constructs and how to apply them. But why can't an iwi be an identity provider? You know, how could we recognize that actually a lot of those Indigenous protocols actually provide a blueprint for integrity, for veracity, et cetera, because they, you know, when you introduce yourself, you're actually creating effectively an identity proofing mechanism, which then determines how well you're trusted. Yeah, there's a lot of those protocols we can actually draw from into the digital world. And then the third article was about equal rights and duties of citizenship. So not just equal and dignified access to services and infrastructure, which I think we all try to do generally, but you know, that gets into protections, privacy, security, digital skills, but it also gets into, you know what, if you don't measure your quality of life outcomes, then you're probably going to be, and if you don't do that in a way which is also culturally contextual, so not just the national framework, wellbeing framework here in New Zealand, but also the Te Whare Tapawha, which is the four pillars of Māori health and wellbeing. If we don't measure in both of those frameworks, then we're not going to be monitoring in both of those frameworks. And then how do you know if you're achieving them? In fact, how do you know if you're if you're creating harm? How do you know if your policies and services are actually actively supporting the human and digital rights framework? And then across all the top of all of it, and this is absolutely critical and quite specific to New Zealand, but governance must be shared. The treaty requires recognition of authority and control across different groups. So we started applying it that way. That then led to layers. Yes, this is a new slide, but it led to the first one, digital whenua, so digital land layer. So, and for each of the layers of infrastructure, we could then have a purpose and principles and some examples. So digital whenua, it came down to how do we ensure everyone has the shared platforms that they need to support high quality life? Digital kāinga layer was about digital self-sovereignty, digital chieftainship is about ensuring that all Māori and Māori, non-Māori, people have the sovereignty over their own digital stuff, with government enabling and respecting as authoritative those systems. And then finally, digital tikanga is about ensuring high, equitable and dignified quality of life with equal rights and duties of citizenship. And for each one of these, you can then start to imagine the governance framework will be slightly different, the monitoring framework will be slightly different, and all of it, of course, overseen by the governance layer. We then started playing around with what are the different tools that might, or reusable capabilities that could fit in each one. So the digital platforms layer, of course, internet is part of that, but also, maybe the federated identity framework is happening at the digital platforms layer, and the identity providers is happening at the self-determination layer. The publicly available legislation and regulations code, I think many of you will know, has been a real thing for me for years now. Would be in the digital platforms layer, because it's a platform upon which we build. And then you might have Māori laws and rules actually encoded as available as code in the self-determination layer, so that when new policies come out, communities can run those policies against their own rules to say, actually, that creates conflict for us. There's some really great work that's been happening in Australia around Indigenous protocols for AI, and that came out through that as well. Digital rights layer ends up becoming around services, around trust infrastructure, around rights and measurements frameworks, and ethical AI framework. So we sort of just started experimenting with, does this framework work? So it's not about whether all the boxes are right. It's more about, as a shape, did the treaty give us a useful framework? And we actually went, well, actually, it's a really profound framework, because rather than clustering technical capabilities by commonality, these things are all part of the connectivity layer, or rather than just clustering them to the technical frameworks, we started clustering them according to their purpose, which then creates a different way to then govern and oversee and implement and maintain these capabilities according to that purpose. And then, of course, over the governance layer becomes around everything from not just means and mechanisms and tools for co-governing, but also real-time monitoring of all of these layers, of all of these patterns, participatory, tools to participate in the design and oversight of all of these things, and getting into those interoperability mechanisms between the layers. And then which parts of this might be digital public infrastructure, or possibly everything but the self-determination layer, maybe. So, but that gave us a lot to think about, and all of the same bits could then be applied to a more traditional, technically based Gov as a platform layer, which is, this is sort of the usual model that I tend to use. But it was really interesting how well it mapped, but also some of the things that didn't quite map into a very traditional model. So I'll stop there. No, I'll go through the other one briefly. The other option is make my day. I will actually stop for a minute. So the other option we're going to go through is designing different futures. Any thoughts or feedback on that model to start? Does it make sense? Without getting into the detail of it, does the framework and the methodology make sense? And could you see applicability of that for yourself? While everyone's having a moment to ponder, Rob, any thoughts or feedback?
Yeah, I'm just digging into the digital platforms layer. My screen's over here, and the reasons why I'm so interested in this particular subject is because of all of those layers, and the only ones that I've basically touched are like the public service layer, inclusive and disabilities and that. So from what I'm learning is government as a platform, it refers to the whole ecosystem. And as Duane Burry has also mentioned, this framework can be applied to all levels of government, like IT departments and all the way up on a global scale. It's so fascinating. I'm only looking at the little tiny piece and learning from you on the whole piece.
Well, and it's interesting because I think the fact our structures are actually part of the problem in government. When we, and this is only a fairly new thing, right? We used to have, or at least in the countries, at least in New Zealand and Australia, I'm not quite so sure about Canada, but up until the 80s and 90s, we did used to have structures that were based around programs. So here are all the people needed for this kind of program. For a social service or for whatever. But in the 80s and 90s with new public management, there was a restructure that basically said, oh no, we're going to cluster functions, business capabilities together. So IT was put over here and the business was over there. And then as new capabilities have come on, they're put into their own space, digital's put over there and data's put over there. And because everyone is structurally, is functionally separated in the structure of our departments, it makes it very hard to actually create a multidisciplinary team because everyone's got to have a cost center, right? So when you start thinking about this, you immediately start seeing that it very much needs to be a multidisciplinary activity. That exercise I just showed you all was not a bunch of techs getting in a room, but nor was it not the techs in the room, because when people say, oh, it's not about the technology, they tend to imply that therefore they don't need technologists. And that's quite dangerous. So what we need to have, and what we did have for that exercise, was we had, people from a cultural perspective and a historical and contextual perspective. We had technologists, we had design, we had data, we had engineers and researchers. It was built in a very short period of time, but it was a very multidisciplinary discussion. In fact, we had a couple of people who were treaty experts. And just trying to build out, and it was an experiment as well. We said, well, let's try from starting from the treaty and just see what happens. And the results were, you know, even better than we'd hoped, but we were totally open to the framework not working, not translating. And so that was really important as well.
How is that data collected? Like, how did you get that data? You know,
we made it up.
Okay.
This is the thing, the human capacity for creativity, like there's so much knowledge that we all have that we don't draw on day to day because we're told, but that's not your job description. Just getting in the room saying, hey, let's experiment with something, and just everyone feeling comfortable to just participate without fear, without, oh, but I'm not an expert in that. Just being like, you know, does this work? You know, does the treaty provide a framework for what we need in the digital age? Let's try it out. That was really, really cool. So really what you need there is less maybe concept of making sure you've got all the subject matter experts in the room, and more concept of just co-creating, and the idea that new knowledge comes through the process, not contributed purely into the process. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, good.
I'm pressing buttons here. My apologies, sir.
No worries. All right, then, given that there's not any other hands up for the moment, I'll jump into the other example, and then we're going to get into, and then we'll jump into the exercise. Boom. Here we go. Okay, so the method two is make my day, make my future day. So thinking about either, and it can be a current or a future state. Here's the use case that I have. It's more use case based. And then effectively reverse engineering your Gov as a platform from the use case. So you're asking the question, what does a great day or a terrible day look like in the future? What's the use case that I have? You're then asking what's needed to support the good day and mitigate the bad one. What is reusable and what isn't? How could I, should I bundle these components logically? What is the ideal role of government in my use case? Because even though the role of government today might be X, Y, and Z, maybe we should be doing X and Z, but should also be doing A. So actually thinking about use cases and then talking them through gives you a chance to use the use case to reverse engineer options. So I think a few of you might have seen, you know, a future potential view of government systems. I have for, you know, quite a while believe that if you virtualize out the presentation layer of government, whether that's for services or any form of service, then our policy infrastructure could actually talk to the same systems because it's been virtualized out. At which point we can get real-time public participation in policy reform or modeling or options or testing, prior to moving forward. But this was sort of the model I brought to the table with Audrey and Christo. Christo had more of a technical framework, but he also has an extraordinary, and I've linked it in these slides that you can play with them a little bit later, an extraordinary framework for future state architecture for those that are interested. But what was really interesting was we didn't talk about the technology as much as you would think, because a lot of it was coming down to the philosophy. The three of us, and amazingly facilitated by Derek and the whole team, but the three of us actually start from the philosophy of Gov as a platform. We came at it from slightly different angles, but talking through the philosophy of it and talking through our use cases gave the opportunity to see where there were areas that overlapped and that overmapped, and to identify, if you like, reusable components. We all agreed that regardless of your jurisdiction, there will be reusable patterns, as it were, and ways that we solve those patterns in different jurisdictions that we could share better together. And so being able to actually do Gov as a platform globally through collaboration with other willing governments and departments and jurisdictions, I think is really critical. And of course, across Canada, you've got so many amazing jurisdictions, to collaborate with, that it's a really helpful thing to be able to collaborate together. So Audrey spoke about the Taiwan contract tracing app, which from a Gov as a platform perspective is very interesting, not just because it was about co-designing with It said civic technologies, actually the civic technologists, it was the word that was meant to say there, but also and building it based on and there were combinations of government and non-government technologies involved in that, but it was about participatory democracy. She gave a lot of stories and a lot of examples about participatory government, participatory democracy, and the ability to not just involve people in the process of government delivering to the people, but actually government being the platform upon which people could serve themselves. Because sometimes our bureaucracy is too slow. Sometimes it does take too long to respond to something that just needs to happen today. And sometimes enabling and engaging people or even just providing the platforms by which people can engage with each other provides a real opportunity for that. So she spoke about the contact tracing app as a really good example of that, where the community just got on with it and really, really quickly. And the government saw its role to encourage, support, engage with, and facilitate, and then scale that out. The community engagement involved not just saying, well, what's the best way to solve this quickly, which is accessible, which protects privacy, which, you know, aligns to the values of the community, but also what were the bits that were needed, not just the technical bits, but the governance bits, the policy bits, the ways of working bits. So this is where Gov as a platform isn't just a technical framework, right? Christo spoke a lot about next generation digital architecture, but he spoke about some of those technical patterns, but he also spoke again about how it's not just about the technology. You can do anything with technology. It's about getting the principles right, the intent right, about having a clear vision of what you're trying to achieve, and then you can apply technology however you want, but creating your technology framework in a way that's modular, extendable, open, really, really big for all three of us. We're very focused on openness as an absolute critical enabler for Gov as a platform, and focused on those reusable patterns gave the opportunity not just for them to deliver very quickly great value, but then to have adaptability moving forward, because the world changes fast around us, user needs change fast, services, policies, it all changes regularly and fast. So modular architecture is absolutely critical and crucial to being able to maintain service and systemic adaptability. I gave a future state example. So I wrote a little story about a future day in the life of a policy professional, in trying to shape and reform and adapt a piece of regulation. And through telling the story, you know, here's what we did, here's the change that's happened, here's how we're trying to respond to that, here's how we engage with people, that then provided an example, a story that we could then say, well, here are all the components that are needed for that. It was very much about data and patterns-based regulation, creating responsive, participatory, and adaptive practices and processes and systems for regulation. So we took those three. We then built out a whole mirror board. We took our three examples, policies and regulations was mine, services, Audrey's, and infrastructure and technology, Christo's. And we just started talking about what is needed for the three of them, which then led to, as you can see, lots of sticky notes. And we're going to be going through that a little bit, but I'm more interested in you excellent folk actually contributing into this. What I'm going to do is stop sharing for a moment, and we'll just, if there's any questions or comments about the exercise, let's go into that. Otherwise, we're going to jump into the mirror board and start hacking together.
I'll throw that in there for you, Pio.
Oh, thank you. Any thoughts or questions or feedback before we jump in? Yes, Natasha, I totally agree. Do you want to just extrapolate on that a little bit?
Sure, coming. Just give me a second. Hi. I'm working at PSPC, our goal is just to introduce a new digital mindset in the department. And what you're presenting, I think, is absolutely tremendous. And I think it would be absolutely amazing to get there. And I'm seeing the road to get there, and I'm seeing the people aspect of it and that change management aspect. And that trust is so fundamental to implement something like this. And I'm just curious to know your thoughts on how we could go about getting there from the people perspective.
Yeah, for sure. So there's two types of trust there, right? It's slightly ironic to me that the word trust or trust framework has traditionally been used as a to refer to an identity framework, which is all about whether government can trust people. But trust has to be about how we trust our own people, and it has to be about how the community can trust us. And those other two aspects are, you know, just absolutely crucial, but not talked about enough, right? So in terms of actually trusting our staff, one of the beautiful things about, and you don't hear this often at all, of course, but one of the unintended benefits coming out of the whole COVID affair and people having to work remotely for, you know, a year and a half in our case, at least, is that after about the third month, the micromanager started to fail. Because if you are the sort of person that needs to see a person working, who wants to delegate a task and then follow up on whether the task has been implemented, that doesn't scale in a virtual workforce. You need to give people the power to make decisions. You need to give people outcomes to achieve how they see fit. And watching the rise of servant leadership as a necessity in a virtualized workforce is really helpful. Now, that needs to be held on to and normalized now, because once you have an appetite for something different, you still need to work through the habits and processes that are inhibitors to those things, right? So being very proactive about the best way for us to scale our impact is to enable and empower our workforce, and let's support that is absolutely crucial, for sure, because you will not get Gov as a platform through outsourcing. You won't, because if you say, here's the thing that we want delivered, any company, and reasonably so, is going to deliver the thing that's needed in accordance with the contract that you've put in place and the minimum, like meeting the requirements is absolutely key. And quite often the requirements will be too many. So just meeting the requirements will be too hard. And very few companies will naturally say, well, we're going to build it all in a fully modular, extendable way, because it always takes just that little bit more effort, not a lot more, but a little bit more effort in the short term in order to save enormous amounts of technical debt down the track. So we need to start investing a little more upfront in order to avoid downstream debt being created by ways of working that are just the shortest term thing, right? Trusting staff to make greater decisions of longevity, but also realizing that we are going to be decreasingly trusted. We need to actually be working more in the open and enabling some of these things to be delivered and supported by a whole universe of organizations. Where we do provide a service, of course, we will always provide services to people, and we must, because we're the government, and we need to provide that platform and that minimum layer of service. But some people will say, you know what, I'm in a really difficult situation and I don't want to go to the government, because what if they take my child? What if they take my support? What if they put me in jail? We're not a company. People don't, you know, the reason that people are more comfortable to give their information to a Google or to a whatever is because Google's not going to arrest them. Like there is a difference there. Anyway, yeah, there's a lot to happen there around culture. And that's why government as a platform, as a principle, as a philosophy, is such an important concept to take back into our planning. Really good point there by Andrew. Census and statistical related activities is a good example of global reusable patterns. Totally agree. Andrew, do you want to expand upon that a little bit as an example? It's a great example, I agree.
Yeah, I mean, I had the pleasure a number of years ago working at Statistics Canada, and I mean, in no way I'm an expert, but where I was going is that I know there's a lot of commonalities amongst like different countries. And I know, for example, at the time, and again, this is going way back, not current, I don't want to be speaking on behalf of what occurs now, but we were borrowing from the US Census and the UK Census. And it just strikes me, like, from a fact-based approach, a lot of these things are going to be very similar. And in fact, and I'll wrap up, I think there's a really good benefit if governments are using a common platform for comparisons and for rolls up. And so, you know, how is my country, how are my citizens doing compared to another country? And from the perspective of learning from countries to improve the social good, it's not like in the sense of a competition. Anyway, just some of my thoughts on that.
No, I really appreciate that. And thank you, Andrew. And it is a good example. I think a lot of my experience is that every country thinks that every other country is doing it better. And I think one of the important things is, first of all, to look within ourselves to acknowledge that every country has things they're doing really well, and every country has things that they could learn from others. But having that confidence in ourselves to say, well, actually, even within our own context, here's a really good pattern that we can repeat. Because while ever we're just looking for someone else to solve the problem, there's collaboration, but then there's also just confidence in ourselves. You can't partner effectively from a position of low confidence. And there are parts of the system that are very confident to engage and parts of the system that are less confident to engage. Thank you, Alex. We totally agree. Audrey is very well respected globally. And it's fantastic to hear the contact tracing app is a good example for government to drive meaningful and positive impact with technologies. Is there anything that you want to expand upon that for the group? Okay. All right. Let's jump into the mirror board then. We're going to have a little bit of time now to run through some questions. Now, you've all got the link there in the chat, and no doubt you've been poking around having a bit of a look. But the first thing I'm going to do is ask you, actually, either on your computer or on a piece of paper, to just take a couple of minutes to write some use case that's important to you. It might be an example of something that you'd like to see government as a platform applied to. It might be an example of a type of service or a day in the life of. I want you to come up with, it can be as simple or as complex as you like, but come up with a use case for yourself. Because in your mind, I want you to then be applying that use case for all the questions we're going to be doing in a moment. So please just take maybe 3 minutes to think about a use case for you. And it might be about your life. It might be, you know, my daughter's about to have a child, and my use case is I'd really love to see, better support and information services for a person, who's about to have a child. It might be I'd like to see a situation where our staff are able to, access all the training that they need to upskill for digital. It could be whatever you want, but just take a couple of minutes to come up with a use case. So what we're going to do in the mirror board is we're going to just bounce around a few questions. I'm going to take you through exactly the same process that we went through as a means of just contributing to this, co-creating some of our thoughts for government as a platform. So the first one, what is the role and shape of government in a post-pandemic world? Now you will have, I'm sure all of you will have interesting ideas about this, and we'll take all of the output of this and I'll wrap it up into a bit of a analysis a little bit later. And of course you can be as anonymous or not anonymous as you like. If you want to be purely anonymous, please feel free to change your name on this. A lot of you are just using the defaults that came in, which is totally fine. So we're going to take maybe a couple of minutes. Add some cards, add some post-it notes. There's a whole stack of post-it notes sitting there waiting on the right-hand side of each of these boxes. So you can just pick one up and move it. You don't need to worry about color coding. Just use whatever color you want. The original colors that we used are irrelevant now. So use whatever color you want and just start adding. What is the role and shape of government in a post-pandemic world? Are you seeing it change? What do you see as the same? What do you see as different? Where do you see an emerging need? Don't even worry too much about the stuff that we wrote, because those were just our thoughts. Your thoughts are just as important and just as valid as anyone else's thoughts. Wonderful. So just to reflect on some of the things that are coming up. One of the concepts that comes up a lot in government is that we should be, like the air fade into the background, that government should be in the background of things. It's actually a really interesting concept. And I do want to just ask people what you think about this, because I think as a, when you start from the principle that government should be invisible, it sort of ignores the fact that there are points in people's life where they absolutely want government to be visible. And I think about emergencies, and I think about not just COVID, but, you know, fires in Australia. Like there are times where the visibility of government is actually a reassurance and good for people's confidence. And then there's also times where, of course, you don't care, you don't even know a particular thing is government. Why can't I just automatically get this thing? And then, of course, there's different levels of privilege and let's call it vulnerability or discomfort with government, which makes that more or less possible based on a person's context. For some people, when we were doing work here in here in New Zealand, but about 5 years ago, looking at proactive services and automated services, we discovered an interesting thing. Some people were like, you know what, if I'm eligible for something, just make it happen. Some people said, just because I'm eligible doesn't mean I want it. I want to be given a choice. I'm not I don't need to be given stuff by the government. And some people were like, I don't want you to automate anything because I don't trust you. And I want to just see what this means for me and my family before I, you know, have any engagement with government, and everything in between. So part of this, I think, is about recognizing that citizens' relationship or people's relationship to government is highly contextual. So providing a means, rather than saying, you know, just this or just that, we need to be able to provide people a means of almost dialing up and down the amount of helpfulness that we are. Because for some people, they don't want any help from us. They will engage when they want to. For some people, they want it to be as automated as possible. Again, this comes down to co-design. If we co-design our not just our individual services with people, because co-designing an individual service doesn't give you Gov as a platform as a shape, but if we co-design some of these questions with the communities that we serve, some pretty profound things will probably come out. So just to jump in, so any thoughts or feedback on that concept? Invisible government as a concept.
Hey, Pia, I work for a municipality. And so what we hear a lot is not about government being invisible, but the distinction between levels of government, because we all know it, we're all working in it every day, but to the average citizen immigrant, knowing whether it's a lower tier municipality, a regional municipality, provincial or federal, or any number of agencies that work within them, can be almost impossible for them to wade through. And we don't connect enough our services to what the user needs, and then linking those activities across the levels of government.
For sure. And look, you've just made a really eloquent and critical point as a rationale for Gov as a platform. No jurisdiction will ever have a mandate for all of it. And even if they do, it wouldn't be across different sectors. No organization will be ever able to serve all of the needs of a person. So making our services, our systems, our rules, our eligibility, even our transactional systems mashable. And yes, you can then control for certain types of transactions, you know, for things that are transactional, you might say, well, we'll only make this mashable by a trusted partner with the right sort of, you know, security framework. But for maybe eligibility criteria, we could just make it open for anyone to use. Like you know, you have still a scale there. It doesn't mean all open or all closed. There's a framework there. But the more that we can make those linkages and that information about our services, their eligibility, their calculation information, the more we can make that information public in a machine readable form, the easier it is for each other to consume and then helpfully refer people, but also for communities themselves. If someone set up a Diabetes Canada organization, there might be one that exists, I'm sorry, I don't know if it does, but there's a Diabetes Australia, they can say, here are all the government services, all the education services, all the health services, all of the, you know, across all of the jurisdictions, because in Australia, of course, we've got the same, we've got local, state and federal. So making ourselves mashable is the only sensible and sane way to create the possibility of referring effectively to each other and of incorporating information across each other. So there's really good stuff in here about government being a bit more listening and a bit more participatory, which is fantastic to see. There's a lot in here about culture, about almost the operations, about how we operate, and of course about making services actually better. And we'll start to cluster these around a little bit post this workshop. We'll go and do a bunch of clustering and insights analysis. But I might just invite people, now you've had a bit of time to think about this question, to just please put your hand up if you'd like to share some thoughts anytime through the next few questions, now or moving forward. But we're going to move into the next question just to start people thinking about it while people do some sharing. So
I was just going to say two things that I kind of quickly want to throw in here that came out of the conversation we had with you, Christo and Audrey. There are two different models. Like, I remember we're talking about, you know, the role of government, and Christo very much presented this idea of government as this thing, like the idea of government walking with you through daily life. And so what I think he had, like the bureaucratus, which is like that AI assist, government AI assistant, kind of like walks with you as you go through your daily life, and you have that ongoing daily relationship with government. Similar to, like, now we're moving in that direction with the private sector. You know, we have a daily conversation with Google, we have a daily conversation with Facebook. What would it look like to have a daily conversation with government? And whereas Audrey's talked a lot about this idea of, like, open data, and the idea that, you know, if government just makes this data open, that gives people the agency to come and engage with government on their own terms. And then, like you said, sort of mash, you know, the mashable idea, like take the data and create things to meet the needs in their own life. So those are two ideas of, like, models of government that came from our conversation.
Well, the interesting thing is, just to riff on that just a little bit, where Audrey took it was open data is necessary but not sufficient. The extra bit on top is not just getting the data out there. It's also about government engaging in a different way. The government of Taiwan are in, I think, the world's best democratic experiment of participatory democracy. And it's by actually changing their processes and their approach to actively engage people in the processes of designing and indeed supporting people to design their own as well, of course. But the notion that government is part of society, not separate from society, is something that I think that is the leading jurisdiction in the world doing. And it's something that I aspire to in the governments that I work in as well. Our processes and presumptions sort of seem to sort of start from the governments separate from everyone. So we'll do our thing, and if we can make something available that you can build on, go for it. And that's a helpful starting point for us. But the next step is, and here's how we could collaborate with you. And you know, not just throwing money over the fence or deregulating, but actually being a partner in solving wicked problems, in solving social problems. We've got a few questions to get through, and I'm just going to, so as I said, I'd love people to share some of their thoughts as they're putting them up here. So please, if there's anyone that's like to share, please put your hand up. We might move to the next question just so people can start adding that in. But the next question down, what could good look like? I'm sure that some of the answers you've put above will replicate here, but we'll just take a couple of minutes to add the next question down, what could good look like for citizens and people? Noting, of course, that not all people are citizens and not all people are Canadians. So add some thoughts in there, and I just want to invite anyone to share from the first question or the second one, any thoughts that they have. Rob, is this all making sense?
I am running around this mural board, loving everything that's going into it. I got to tell you this, and I'm so glad that Derek's come to join us. And Derek and I have had lots of conversations when we were working back at TBS about government of a platform and what would that look like for Canada. So I'm thinking back to all those conversations. Derek, remember those?
Man, so many good conversations. And we were trying to actually live it out, like through the projects we were working with the GC Tools, we were trying to actually build this government as a platform and enable that, both on a technical side of things, but also on a cultural side of things. Those are heady days, man, heady days.
And that's why I love when Pia comes in here and she's like, Rob, you're thinking too small. You need to think, you know, a little bit more grand. It's great to get that feedback.
I think let me take a moment just while people are adding in some thoughts into the board. Let me just take a moment to differentiate between government as a platform government platforms and government as a service. And these are just my thoughts. This is such a rapidly evolving area. I would suggest that no one like should feel intimidated by, you know, being, there's no such thing as a subject matter expert in this. We are all co-creating this space, but let me just tell you some of my thoughts about how I differentiate between those. So government platforms, there will always be government platforms, but shared platforms, you know, can be helpful for efficiency perspective and helpful for people to build upon, but isn't necessarily going to lead to government as a platform, because shared platforms the difference in characteristics are, can the public build value on it? That's really the big difference, because if you're just sharing stuff across departments, that's helpful from a government platform's perspective, from an efficiency perspective, from a modular services perspective, etc. But if you're not building something, if you're not actually, the philosophy of Gov as a platform is that anyone can build value on the top of, can mash it up with something else, can do something that you haven't anticipated with it, which is, you know, for some people that's a bit scary, but that's the point, is that if you only engage with the world in the ways that you can imagine, then you are now constrained by yourself. You're constraining the world artificially and creating yourself as a bottleneck. Actually recognizing that the world is moving very fast and that we are just a player on the stage, as it were, and that, you know, the best play is not done by one person, but by a troupe of actors. We need to be engaging with the other actors on the stage. We need to see ourselves as part of civil society, not separate to civil society. And every single person that is a public servant is also a citizen, is also involved in the community in myriad ways. Why can't we be involved in the community as public servants? And that, of course, means a change to how we think about comms, because a lot of departments now see the public as this thing that you can only engage with through a comms department, which then creates an artificial barrier to actual collaboration, to actual engagement, and to actual actual partnership. If partnership is only through a contract, then you're never actually having a partnership, you're just having a vendor relationship. So we need to think about ourselves as part of something bigger. And this is where I think Taiwan has really shifted that mental pattern. And this is one of the challenges I'm going to set for you all. Okay, we're going to jump to the next question. If you've got more things there, please do them. I've got some hopes and fears things on the right-hand side here. So if you want to treat this as one question and sort of take what are your hopes and fears for government as a platform? Hopes on the right-hand side at the top, fears right-hand side at the left. So from a hopes perspective, you could, for instance, add what sort of value you think could be created by citizens, what sort of value could be created by you, what do you think are the possibilities of sort of what we've been talking about, and then fears, what are you worried about down the bottom? And some people will start at one and go to the other and vice versa, but let's just take a few minutes to capture some of your hopes and fears about this concept, and then we're going to go and build some Gov as a platform together. Been a few good comments in here. Thank you very much. Dana, did you want to extrapolate a little bit upon the comment that you made about the idea that government is a platform, a government as a public service in people's lives?
Sure. I think I 100% hear what you're saying about government as a platform and allowing people to build on it. But I think one of the barriers that we have right now is that as levels of government, we're not building on each other's platforms. We're all building platforms. And until we can figure out how to treat each other's services as a platform, I think opening up to consumers, again, like every other choice, we're asking them to make a choice on the platform they're choosing or the service that they need based on the government that they need, as opposed to demonstrating and learning as we do it. If I'm in a township, like I'm in a small township, and I want to build a citizen portal, then I should be building on something that's already built instead of hiring a vendor and building another citizen portal. And we could learn a lot by working with other levels of government and then enabling those guides and training out to citizens and companies and all those things by doing it ourselves first? That was just the question. That excites me. Government of the platform is figuring out how to take levels of government out of the picture for the average person and just provide the services.
Yeah, for sure. Look, there's a lot in there, and those are really good insights. And I think there's a few things to consider. Every jurisdiction, every department within every jurisdiction, and frankly, every team within the departments within each jurisdiction will always be subject to different pressures from each other. There will always, and we're never going to see a situation where everyone's running at the same speed in the same direction at the same time with the same enablers. So everyone's going to be running through patches of molasses at times and on slippery ice at times, right? So I think one of the keys here is if in every action you take, in every program, in every service, in every policy, in every build, in everything you're doing today, if you can enact the principle, even if you haven't got it all perfect, but you can enact the principle and the philosophy, then you will drive the change naturally. It becomes the light on the hill that we're all working towards as government, as a platform, as a print, as a philosophy, becomes a common light on the hill that we can all do. If we wait for each other, then we will all get stuck in the molasses at the same time and forever. If we wait for the perfect, then the good will never eventuate, because the perfect will never eventuate. And if we make, like, there are certain things that we could commit to now. For us to provide referral to each other, we need to know what each other has, which only really requires two things that every jurisdiction could do, or at least two jurisdictions could do, and it would immediately make a difference. What is your register of services? What are the actual services you all provide? You know, and this is where the UK have actually done some really good work around common registers. They have register.gov.uk, I think it is, or registers.gov.uk. What's your register of services in a programmatic form? It doesn't have to be exactly the same. You don't need to spend 10 years coming up with a perfect standard before you start doing a register. Just do what you've got, and then we can standardize later, but at least we can do translation between them. And what are the eligibility and access requirements for those services? So that's where we get into to my mind, rules as code, but however you want to make that available. And if every jurisdiction could just say, here are the services we provide and the criteria by which you get access to those services, suddenly every jurisdiction could just refer to each other. Suddenly you could mash up, you know, even just the information about services and how to get access to them and what's relevant to each other. That is a simple example where you don't have to wait for the perfect, but you could just do it today because you need it for your own systems anyway. If you want to do referrals, you know, when you're providing information about your own services to people, a lot of that content is currently captured in content management systems because everyone went, to full web rather than modular architecture. That's a basic thing everyone could do. The other thing is just adopting the virtualized presentation layer. If everyone adopted the idea that the presentation layer of our services is separate from the back end, you're suddenly forced at an architectural level, at a delivery level, at an implementation level, to make everything that you do accessible through a programmatic interface, which means it is now possible to mash up. So if you there's a couple of things that you could do now, and it doesn't require permission and it doesn't require ministerial approval because it's just operational structure. And if you can talk to your architectural groups and get, you know, that basic modular architecture and decoupled front ends endorsed as a principle. And for what it's worth, there's been some really good work at ESDC around adopting some of these architectural principles that could be reused across, you know, all the jurisdictions right now. Then there's some opportunities there. Sorry, go ahead, Rob.
Sorry, I literally could listen to you folks talk about this and be on the mirror board all day because I am learning so much from this. But we only have
four or five minutes left. All right. Well, then very quickly, I might just quickly jump down. So, I mean, we've really got, I'm so sorry. We've got caught up on the questions. The next section down the bottom, which you're welcome to keep adding on over the course of the day or the next couple of days, is what are the core building blocks? So you can see the sort of building blocks that we put in place. If I can ask whoever's got presentation, Derek, to just pan down to the circles diagram just out big. Those are some of the components we talked about. And some of those components were technical and some of them were process oriented or philosophical. So you can see the sort of stuff that we did. You can add stuff in. Please have a think about what you think it would take. Your use cases will probably fall into one of these three categories, right? It'll either be something around a service, it'll be something around policy regulations, or it might just be a bit more generic. Whichever one it falls into, please, over the course of the next day or so, when you've got a bit of spare time, when you've got a bit of a break, just, you know, throw in any thoughts that you have. And my commitment to you is that in about 2 days' time, I will go and work with the others to pull all of this together into a bit of a report and a report with some recommendations about Gov as a platform. So everything you say will be read and reported and will help actually contribute to the commons that we have all just contributed to. We have all just contributed to building out and co-creating Gov as a platform. Congratulations and welcome to the revolution. So I might just leave it there and if there's any other comments, I'll pass back to you, Rob.
Well, thank you very much, Pia. Like I said in the very beginning, I don't actually know a lot about this particular subject, but this was fantastic to be a part of this. And of course, looping in Derek there, of course, to come in. Fantastic. Listen, I understand it a little bit better than I did at the beginning of this of your workshop. And also don't go far away, because Pia is going to be at the keynote main stage at 3:40 p.m. Folks, also make sure that you check out our speakers' profiles. Pia's is, of course, located, you know, connect, collaborate, start a conversation. You know, this workshop doesn't end today, it continues. And hit that interested option, book a meeting and connect. So Pia, as usual, thank you very much for hosting this incredible workshop, Government as a Platform. And that is a wrap in Channel 4. So back to the main stage. That's it. Thank you very much.